feel like to blow holes in the heads of rednecks.
It's the stuff of rock legend. Australia's National Youth Radio Network, Triple J, starts its Unearthed competition, inviting Australian bands to submit unreleased music. First year in, 1995, they unearth four Lismore lads who shoot to overnight success with a track called Sick Fest. Grinners are go. You can't
try to fail. We kind of sent in this demo that we'd done in a night, and that we won. We came out, we won, we're really happy, and we got a bit of play on the radio.
Had you recorded before you recorded Sick Fest?
No. I'd recorded before, but not as a band. That was the first thing we recorded.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So you must have been pretty pleased when the first thing you recorded as a band got picked to be unearthed.
Shocked.
Yeah.
Shocked.
I couldn't believe it.
Stunned.
Stunned. Absolute disbelief.
Looks like it hasn't worn off yet.
Yeah. There was a big scene in Lismore
when we came through.
When we started, there's a lot of really good bands, mainly from the uni, you know. And it was really exciting because I really like admired all these bands, and we started to get to play with them. And yeah, it was years ago, but I was 17.
Mm. And then we won Unearthed, and we were totally ostracised from the whole Lismore music scene.
Because every band had entered, and we won.
Grinspoon had formed earlier in '95 after meeting at their local pub's jam night. Vocalist Phil Jamieson was 17 at the time.
I met Chris when I was 14.
And I met Joe, I was like 20.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, what
and then
that
I met him when we were at the pub.
Yeah, we were at the pub. I met Joe at the pub. I met Pat at his house.
Me and Joe knew each other.
And Chris knew each other. And we kind of met all together at a pub in Lismore.
The band took their name from a pro-marijuana activist called Dr. Lester Grinspoon.
Apparently he's really aware of us. He's got our CDs and stuff.
Hello, Grinspoon. You guys go off, man. I love you so much.
We love you too.
Unearthed gave Grinspoon the kind of national interest that young bands dream of. Sick Fest was Triple J's number one most requested song for 7 weeks and appeared on Grinspoon's first self-titled EP.
It was Grin.
It was just Grin.
It was just untitled.
It was called Grinspoon, but it got the name the Green EP because it was just Grin. We weren't into our art.
And you pressed that yourself?
We actually went to every record company in Australia and every single one of them told us that
it was shit.
We had no chance of success. There was absolutely no point in ever coming to success.
Yeah. Tours followed to support the release. Grinners then recorded another 6 tracks with producer Phil McKellar from Triple J, including Post-Inebriated Anxiety.
What are you singing?
I need a bit, give me a hit. That's all it is. But it's just words. It's the eat words. It's eat. Sounds good. Doesn't matter what's in the middle, really.
We've got a bit of a tour schedule here, and there's a lot of dates on it. You know, touring, is that something you've done a lot of in the past?
Yeah, a fair bit.
Yeah.
Enough to drive us crazy for a little while. So, yeah. We did it till we couldn't really do it anymore, then we took a break. It paid our way, like,
not financially
successful, but we got to see the country, we didn't have to pay for it, we didn't exactly make money.
We've got friends in high places at VFS.
Yeah. It's not really a stage show, is it, you know? We don't do a show. It's not a show. We're not all that coordinated to be able to do a show.
We can't dance.
We can't dance, you know. But try and make the song sound good. That's what's important.
And more musicianship over showmanship.
It's just we're such bad musicians, we have to try really hard.
Just concentrate,
like,
playing.
You can't move because you're trying to play.
Yeah. Album or another EP? Or
hopefully we'll do an album.
Nice. Yeah. And would you record it in Australia?
Yeah, probably do it at home.
As in at home, in your home?
No,
or home recording?
North Coast.
Okay.
In February of 97, Grinspoon started work on their debut album at Rocking Horse Studios in Byron Bay, the band's new hometown.
We're all going to live in Byron Bay for December, so we can record the next album. But then we don't really have a home, but we originally came from Lismore, but we left Lismore like years ago because we never got back there anyway, because we were touring all the time. So really, our home is the road.
Grinspoon's Guide to Better Living was released in September 97 and quickly went gold, thanks to some solid touring support. The band is quick to credit producer Phil McKellar.
We love Phil. We love Phil so much. I don't think we're ever going to leave Phil.
We've worked with Phil McKellar from the very beginning when we first got Unearthed. and we recorded Sickfest. He came up to Lismore and we recorded it up there and kind of built a relationship from there. You know, we've got similar tastes in movies and that kind of stuff, and we understand his sense of humour and he understands us.
He knows how we work and, you know, knows our limits and can push us past them.
We got a similar kind of ideas about what's good and what's bad.
It's just good energy to have around.
Commercial success is not just the only thing that drives them. Like, they do have a pretty solid sense of integrity and how they want to achieve their music.
Constant touring throughout the summer of 97-98 earned the record platinum status shortly after the release of the fourth single, Just Ace.
Well, we were just surprised. We thought maybe we sold 15,000 copies and we were going to be really happy, 10,000 copies or something. But
companies, they have a projection of how many records they think you're going to sell, and we were the 15,000 band.
Yeah,
so we did better than that.
Yeah, a little bit better.
In 1998, Universal Records in New York picked up Grinspoon's Guide to Better Living album. Grinners then spent 10 of the next 12 months touring the States, knowing that breaking the US market meant a back-breaking tour schedule.
When we first went over there for a promo tour, that was the vibe from all the record company people that we met. It was like, we've had a few Australian bands over doing two-week stints, and they just don't bother putting time or effort into, you know, working them and doing all that, because they're obviously, you know, not there to stay. And
we go to certain parts of America and we're really well received. Las Vegas, we do really well there. It's because radio's so chopped up in America. Like, there's no youth community network like we have here. It's all one radio station pick you up, another might not. In Boston, there's a big radio station called WWAF who are responsible for breaking lots of big bands on the East Coast, really influential, and they picked us up early on. And so we go to Boston, we do big shows there. And Texas,
they like their, yeah, they like their rock down there.
Lots and lots of miles, lots of gigs. It's such a big place to cover.
Yeah.
I think we lapped it maybe three times while we're there.
Grinspoon's Pushing Buttons EP, featuring Black Friday, was recorded in New York in between live commitments. This CD went gold as well.
We recorded it in the Hit Factory.
Yeah.
Just amazing. Like, everything had been recorded there, and we were just... How much is this costing? It's like, wow. It was good, but we were really lucky to be in there too. Yeah. And the producer was really good. Really made a good sound, I think. We've written that song a long time ago. We've been playing it in Australia live for maybe a year and a half before we went over there, because we just enjoyed it so much.
Yeah.
And so when we went in there, we were always going to be playing it hard. It's a heavy track.
Right. Lots of guitars.
Lots of guitars. It has been weird, but it's been good. We've learned, yeah, exactly. We've seen a lot and learned a lot, so that's what we reckon we're pretty fortunate.
Learning as they go, that's Grinspoon. For some insights into the world according to Grinspoon, we turn to the frontman, Phil Jamieson.
All my friends are creative geniuses. I surround myself with those kind of people.
I never really consider myself a rock star. I'm an artist.
Songwriting's hard. I think anyone that tries to write songs has problems with it, because it's hard.
I fall over really well and I stumble.
Yeah, but I thought that was part of
it. Yeah, well, I stumbled. I've definitely copyrighted the stumble, but yeah.
Pat asked me to shave him once. I don't want to shave anyone, ever. I have enough trouble shaving myself. And when, you know, Pat's all lathered up, you know, and he's trying to look all sexy, he's going, come on, Phil, come and shave me. Like this. I'm going, no, I'm not doing that.
After the break, we'll be hanging some more with Grinspoon, who finally get to come home from their epic American journey.
The war in Iraq continues.
11 people injured in a house fire.
Over the bad news.
Shut up.
Well, here's the good news. 4:30 each day, V serves up your dose of music, news, and all the stuff that matters to you.
It's exciting, it's really exciting.
Don't get in line for the gossip. Hear it first and have your say on V News. 4:30 every day. Only on Channel V. Duh.
If you're a satellite subscriber yet to hook up to digital, strap yourself in. And get ready to land the big catch. The biggest digital preview ever. It's your chance to see what digital is all about over 8 big days. Not only will you see exclusive shows like Aria Icons and exclusive digital channels like Fuel, the A1 Adventure Channel, Club V and VH1, there's also an awesome selection of movie channels. And your favorite channels time-shifted by 2 hours. That's all the entertainment you need for 8 big days. Be sure not to miss the boat when the Big Catch starts this Friday. The Big Catch Digital Preview. See your magazine or website for details.
Hello, host Craig.
It was September 98 and Grinspoon were finally home to see the year out after touring their butts off supporting Guide to Better Living.
And how are you feeling about being home?
I'm ecstatic. Great to be here, and it's lovely. I'm lying on the beach at Whale Beach, and I'm soaking up the sun, and I'm enjoying, because I haven't seen my friends for like 6 months or something, so it's been good to catch up with everyone and have a few days off. You've got 10 days off, so it's like a big holiday for us.
What was the first thing you did when you got back to Australia?
I got some beer, and I bought some Vegemite, and drank the beer and ate the Vegemite on bread with a bit of cheese, Australian sushi.
By this stage, Phil and the lads were chomping at the bit to record their second album.
As soon as we can get in there, we're really keen to get in there and do it.
Where?
Here. He's good. Yeah. We've been overseas all this year, basically. So.
Maybe we might bring someone over or something to do it with us, but definitely. Yeah.
A bit of fresh blood in there is always good. Like, we definitely keep a lot of our own ideas in what we record.
What we're recording, but it's good to get fresh blood. That's
sure.
True.
Sure. Is there a temptation with the next recording to go even a step further to alter even your musical sound, the style of songwriting, whatever?
We hope to get faster. But,
but I don't think it's any. I don't know if that.
It's tricky,
majorly
isn't it?
Drastic.
We're not thinking of changing our formula.
Yeah.
Our cynical formula we've got going.
Mm-hmm.
If we think that's what we're
like
our winner.
What we do.
If we don't enjoy playing it, then we usually won't play it.
Right.
Because you've got to play it like 100 more times. Or
yeah.
Grinspoon's DVD, 23 Hours of Waiting Around, tells a slightly different story.
We've been touring in the States for like the last 18 months and stuff, and we probably were burnt out and out of control and we were going through an interesting phase.
We'd written a lot of material on the road in the States, so we probably only had at least 7 decent songs. And we'd already been booked to play The Big Day Out, so we needed to record it and get it out, so we'd do The Big Day Out. It's kind of a bit of a mess, really.
Grinspoon took to the studio with American producer Jonathan Burnside to record what would become the album Easy, released in November 1999.
I think the fact that Guide was so successful, took a bit of the pressure off.
Nobody really expected Better Living to do as well as it did, so
they gave us a little bit of free rein.
You get a rock band, you get them to play really loud, and then you make it sound a bit louder, and you're done.
And just over the period of the 2 years, demoed a lot of songs, and kind of when a producer came in, he picked the ones that he liked the best, and we kind of have an argument about where it was going and the songs we ended up with. Because we had like 30 or something, the songs we ended up with ended up like being musically where we wanted to go.
And you play him a song that you like and he goes, so is that it? he was harsh, but it was cool. He was honest, you know, and he was really passionate about the songs, that ones he wanted to do. And he chose some songs that I was like, oh, I don't know, but they actually turned up really good.
Yeah. Just because he really liked it, you know, and that's all that was really important to us. We get a producer that likes the music rather than getting someone that's all highly paid and like really flash.
And doesn't care.
And just doesn't care.
Even before the album hit the shops, it went gold. Easy.
We could have done another Guide to Better Living, you know, we probably had the songs there in that vein, but we also had a lot of different stuff, you know. some poppy stuff and some maybe a bit of slower stuff. It's not balls out beginning to end, this album. It's probably mature, but we're a bit older now, so...
Can I just read out this piece that I read about your new album, Easy? Easy stinks of a good root, wet spots on the sheets, and post-sex cigarettes. What a call.
Yeah, that guy's a tripper, huh?
Is that apt, you reckon?
I don't know. I think it's someone's opinion. I thought it was quite good.
He really liked the
you
album.
You really liked the album,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah, like... Raving reviews. Loved it.
Is sounding Australian important to Grinspoon?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Don't you think we sound Australian? I think
we do. That's
I think we do.
A lot of bands, as they get bigger, they try to water themselves down as sounding American or British or... Get amongst it!
Oh, yeah.
What's up?
We've been taking it easy, actually.
Yeah.
Taking it very easy. Had Christmas, New Year's, didn't do anything. Kind of played around at home, went to the beach.
You had some shows in Silverchair over Christmas?
We went up to Queensland in Silverchair. We went up to Cairns, Townsville,
somewhere
Rockhampton.
Else. Rockhampton.
That big outdoor show with them in Rockhampton.
And that was with Jebediah as well.
That
was
nice.
Fun.
Yeah.
That was a good bill.
Bonding.
Lots of bonding.
Always.
Lots of fun.
G-ups?
Yeah, there was a little bit of fighting going on. I think Joe had a bit of a run-in with...
Yeah, he did too, with...
Ben Gillies, was it?
Yeah,
yeah, a bit of a wrestling thing happening.
Over what?
I think it was over... Who's the gayest? Or who's
wow.
the toughest or
yeah.
something along those lines. Who's the better bass player?
It's like the battle of the jockeys. Yeah. Randwick, racing.
But what did you do for New Year's? The exact moment that we became the year 2000.
I was watching, I was up at Avalon and they had a big projector and I watched all the fireworks on the TV in Sydney and I had a bottle of Cristal champagne, like Puff Daddy does.
I love it.
And I was puffing it and I was sipping this Cristal. It was a really, really good night.
Fuck yeah!
ARIE Awards in general, what does that mean to you?
Not much.
Mm.
I don't know.
Not too important, we don't think about it too much. I mean, I couldn't really care if we won one or not. It's a good thing to, you know... get onto, but
I don't know.
It's a sales-driven thing,
yeah.
That, you know.
By the turn of the millennium, Grinspoon had enjoyed many critical and popular plaudits, including multiple ARIE Award nominations. In typical Grinspoon fashion, they took it all very seriously. Not.
We're very, you know, excited about being nominated and
yeah.
stuff, and going to the party because we like parties.
Mm.
What are you going to wear? I'm thinking about embroidered little socks with little ducks around the top, with some nice like tight stubbies, with a long white sleeved shirt with like a Ronald McDonald kind of work tie, you know, that kind of green and colour.
Cool.
Yeah, cool. I'm thinking that could be a winner. Even if I don't win, I'll be a winner.
You'll be a winner on the night.
That's right, because I'll be looking better than anyone. So. That's my plan, but it could change.
And I'm staying at the Novotel in room 742. Come along to the party afterwards.
And so when are you going to have a new album out?
Hopefully we'll record around January, February. If we've got it, we don't want to do an album until we've got a really good one to put out. So, like, at the earliest, probably record January, February, out by the middle of next year.
Album number 3, New Detention, was released on the 3rd of June 2002, with 12 tracks including the singles Chemical Heart and Lost Control.
We're pretty happy it's out, yeah. It's taken a while, so it's good that it's out now, yeah.
It hasn't taken yonks, what happened?
We kind of just took a bit of time off, really.
We went to Bali for a while as a bonding thing for us all four.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Produced, recorded and mixed by Grinspoon's old pal Phil McKellar, New Detention hit the mark, cementing a reputation they've been slogging their guts out for since 1995.
We sold 100,000 of that first record that we did and I think we all thought this is going to be easy, you know, this will be easy, we'll go to America, we'll blow up and do it pretty easy, maybe some sort of semi-Silverchair sort of story or something. And so wasn't going to turn out like that and hasn't turned out like that, and it's been a lot of hard work to get to here, and here's a good place to be so far.
in Hanging with Grinspoon, we find out how they built their party boy reputation and just what are those Sunday pills. Here's another fresh meat audition tip, dress to success. There's a few things I regret doing in the auditions process. Yeah, I think on the first few days I try to be a bit cool, but it's not about being cool, it's about being yourself. Also, try and wear clothes at all times. And when you're in the shower. You never know, the camera crew's going to be coming around.
What are you doing here?
I came to let you know that you got the job at Channel V.
You know, you don't want to be leaving yourself open and vulnerable and naked in a towel, dancing around like a girl. Squealing.
Check out Fresh Meat 4pm daily to see who's made the grade.
Over time, Grinspoon not only established their rock credentials, they became the undisputed kings of shit-stirring. ARIA winner Alex Lloyd in particular copped a flogging in their early days. By the early 2000s though, the boys were showing signs of remorse. Sort of.
Are you the last bad boy of rock and roll in Australia?
Alex Lloyd is definitely the last bad boy of rock and roll.
Now, I read an article that said you actually retracted every bad thing you ever said about Alex Lloyd.
I never said anything bad about Alex Lloyd. His publicist is...
He only spoke the truth.
Yeah, I only spoke the truth, but he did give me a Chinese burn at the Gold Coast. And it really hurt.
Alex is a friend now. We get along really well. He actually co-wrote some of this record. No, he didn't. But no, me and Alex are good friends.
And what about your other enemies in the music
industry? I don't have any. I think we've just started a war recently with Thirsty Merc, but
Tone it down a little bit. There's obviously people still out there who still hate us.
I think we just used to say that stuff to get a reaction too. But it's funny. It's funny seeing people react and get all angry over some stupid thing you said. And it was just funny something to say. It's like what Pat said before. It's the first thing that comes to your head. You've done 100 million interviews and you just think, well, now I'll just throw a curveball. So, you know, we don't really hate anyone, actually. Just for fun.
We did call Powderfinger the Eagles.
No, that was in the 90s.
Yeah, but then
I called them that.
Then they called
don't
us.
Take my quote.
Oh, sorry.
No,
sorry,
is that not being
they called us Pantera Light.
Diet Pantera.
Diet Pantera, was it?
It was back in 96. I called the Eagles in the 90s. And then what did they do? They went on to sell as many records as the Eagles. I was not wrong. I should take it as a compliment.
Right now, they've got a brand new album in a couple of days. Please give it up for Grinspoon. Hard act to follow.
Grinspoon's fourth album, Thrills, Kills and Sunday Pills, was unleashed on Sunday, 19th September 2004. That's a funny day to put a record out, isn't it?
Yeah, well, the name of the album's got Sunday in the title, so therefore we thought it'd be good to bring it out on a Sunday.
Are many people...
You know, it makes sense.
...out and about on a Sunday? Are they out and about buying records on a Sunday?
I've got no idea.
Neither do I.
Can I get each of you to explain what Sunday Pills are?
Yeah, it's Barocca.
I would have said Nurofen.
Panadol. Maybe Eckies.
Panadol Fort.
Fans and critics agreed it was a more grown-up album in both its songwriting and technical prowess. Some fans were disappointed it didn't rock as hard. Could it be true? Were Grinspoon really growing up?
Nothing very grown up about rock and roll.
No.
But people keep telling us we're growing up.
It's like a 20-year-old in a suit.
You're feeling awkward?
A little bit.
Now, this is what you said was your personal album.
Yeah, it's personal lyrically, yes.
Yeah.
But I don't know when that means it's grown up. It's kind of be like PJ for JF on front of your, pencil case. Is that grown up?
No.
No.
And that's what you are lyrically?
No, I wouldn't say that. I would say it's personal lyrically compared to other stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But I don't know whether that means it's grown up or not.
And what about you, Pat? Like, the guitar sound has changed significantly.
Yeah, it's a little bit more classic. Yeah, it was good. I think that was when we went in to make the album. We wanted to do something that was a little less, metal-y or kind of, a little cheap sounding. So I spent a lot of time working on the guitars and just trying lots of different things and lots of different sounds. And I think it's my best work, personally.
Nice.
Hey, I'm backing myself, man.
The guitar refinements on Thrills, Kills and Sunday Pills were due in part to the contribution of producer Howard Benson. Grinspoon travelled to LA to record with him.
We just thought it was a good idea to go to the States because you're working with someone that we'd never met him before. He had no idea about our little history or what we were about, so he just kind of came in with fresh ears and just judged it on the songs we had then, not what maybe our fans or record company or anyone thought of Grinspoon in the past, so it kind of gave us a fresh, in a way, a fresh start.
Would you please welcome folks at home, Ben Street Fox Studios Australia, the most dangerous band on the big day out, Bill, Pat and Phil from Grinspoon!
Somewhere along the way, Grinspoon acquired a reputation for partying. How did that happen?
We smoke. We did drugs. We drink, you know.
I'm going to go get drunk right now.
You drink a lot. And then we had a gig that night at CBGB's. And it was like our second last night in the States. We'd been there for months. And me and Chris, like, semi out of it. Anyway, and then Chris gets up there, like, fourth song he's playing away, like, straight off the back of the drum right now. And off the back, like, legs sprawling in the air sort of thing.
It tastes like syrup. Sweet, but good.
Sweet. Syrupy, but it's 22% alcohol, so...
Well, that's kind of a bad thing.
And yet, when you ask Grinspoon about their reputation for partying...
I don't know what you're talking about, Mum.
This is my first drink of the day.
Yeah. Well, sometimes it's a bit of an illusion that we're maggots, but a lot of the times we are out of it.
I don't really think we're that outrageous. I think a lot of bands are into drinking and doing that stuff, and I think as you're getting older and more decrepit, I think we can, especially the hangovers get worse, you know?
I don't think we're that self-destructive. I mean, we do things to a point, but seriously, most of the stuff about us being, you know, over the edge and all that kind of stuff is basically all bullshit. We work pretty hard when we need to, and when we have the opportunity to have a good time, we do that as well.
Yeah.
But we don't do either to great excess.
The body even takes a bit of biffo now and then.
1, 2, 3, 4!
Every time we go to New Zealand, we end up fighting each other.
Yeah.
It's just an aggressive place.
I don't know, it's weird. We get out of there.
It's the Ixians.
They don't talk properly and they don't...
Full. Hey, Full, how are you?
Yeah.
I'm Full and Pierce. I'm not your Pierce. Full and
not Full.
The Grinspoon DVD, 23 hours of waiting around, reveals an earlier, very dramatic punch-up in New Zealand.
It was at the end of the American tour. I was really wasted, actually, a little bit. It was 2 weeks before we recorded these.
And we're all pretty agitated with each other. It was all getting a bit much. We had a little break, and I think Joe and Phil had a bit of a scuffle on stage.
Yeah, we'd just gotten back from the States. We'd had, like, 1 or 2 days at home, and then we took off from New Zealand, and we were doing this stupid big air comp. I threw my bass at him, and then as I was picking it up, he didn't really like that, which I can totally understand. I feel very embarrassed about it, to be perfectly honest. I love Joe. Like, really, really sad that I did it. And it was a really cheap shot. what didn't kill us made us grow stronger, and, you know, that's kind of... It was the lowest point of the band, in my opinion.
We're still here and still doing it, and we're all still great mates, which is a good thing, because I highly doubt you could be in a band and do this if you weren't good mates.
We don't have a video shop together.
Okay, me and Chris would open a video shop. What would you guys do together? Not the obvious answer.
We'd probably, I don't know, trying to get on one of those reality TV programs, yeah. Like Channel V or Big Brother or something.
I want to get on Home and Away.
I'd definitely be the bad, like, guy, yeah. Driving, like, a bad car and stuff.
Yeah.
I'm putting together a Benga Boys stomp boy band. No, I'm not in it. I'm just creating it. So it's going to be called, like, Long Dong. It's a really dodgy sexual reference.
Where do you see yourselves when you're old men?
Oh, I don't know. Somewhere different.
Florida. On the Keys, hanging out on the beach.
I guess once we stop having fun, we'll go and do something else.
That makes it fun.
It's fun, you know.
Probably start playing golf.
Yeah.
We're never going to break up.
Never.
No. Nah.
Well, me and Joe won't.
No. Nah. Because we're going to be going longer than the Rolling Stones.
Oh, awesome.
We'll be being wheeled onto the stage.
Yeah.
So, you know, I won't be able to remember the gig. That won't be much different. But anyway.
Game. World of Warcraft.